Testament reading is from the book of Jeremiah, the first chapter, verses 4 through 10. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." Then I said, "O Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say, 'I am only a boy,' for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord." Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, "Now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and to pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant." The epistle lesson is from the first book of Corinthians, 13th chapter, verses 1 through 13. "If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may be boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends, but as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now, we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, and the greatest of these is love." The gospel lesson is from Luke chapter 4, verses 21 through 32. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is this not Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, heal yourself.' And you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard you did at Capernaum.' And he said, 'Truly I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel in the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and that there was a severe famine over all the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them except to a widow at Zarephath in Sidon. There was also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian." When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up, drove him out of the town, and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Grace, peace, and God, our Heavenly Father, His Son, Jesus Christ, our blessed Lord. Now we're in it. The elections are beginning. Have you heard a lot of political rhetoric up to this point? Have you been motivated and inspired by the tight arguments that have been shared with all of us in the political process? Not a bit? Goodness gracious. Now we're in it. We're coming to the time when we as citizens get to express our preference. How are you going to make your choice? How are you going to come to your conclusion when you go into the ballot box and pull the lever? How are you going to know what to pull? Challenging times, times for us to be prayerful people. One of the ways I sort of like to process all these different candidates is to imagine what their campaign song might be. Yeah, I probably need therapy. I admit it. What song will we be singing as they go down the campaign trail? My goodness, isn't that something to think about? If nothing else, maybe I'll send you home with that one today. I mean, think of it. There have been occasions when some great, great music has been employed to try and embody the substance of a political campaign. I mean, for example, does anyone here remember the tune that was used for FDR? Anyone? Happy days are here again. Now I know you weren't there when they were singing. You know, a tune can sort of inspire and get the troops together and gather people. What was that? Speak up, it's okay. It's a dialogue, sir.
He asked me if I voted for him the first time.
Oh. Let me try another one. Do you remember the tune that was used for President Clinton, Bill Clinton?
Don't stop.
Interesting, huh? How about President Obama? What was that song? Now I got you stumped. It's interesting. But we can still remember FDR's song, but not necessarily other songs. As you look at the political field, what song might each candidate want us to be singing? Well, I went back to take a look at one of my favorite presidents. I looked back at somebody I spent a lot of money on for buying books about. His name is Abraham Lincoln. Probably doesn't surprise you, I have a picture of Lincoln in my office. And maybe if you watched a PBS special or two or anything regarding the Civil War, you will have heard the bow that was used and is always embraced and lifted up as the bow that was used for President Abraham Lincoln. It is full of substance. It is full of great thoughts. Hooray for the choice of the nation, our chieftain so brave and so true. We'll go for the great reformation, for Lincoln and liberty too. You've heard it, right? We'll go for the son of Kentucky, the hero of Hoosierdom through. The pride of the Huskers so lucky, for Lincoln and liberty too. Our David's good sling is unerring. The slavocrat's giant he slew. Then shout for the freedom preferring, for Lincoln and liberty too. They'll find what by felling and mauling our rail maker statesmen can do. For the people are everywhere calling for Lincoln and liberty too. Then up with our banner so glorious, the star-spangled red, white, and blue. We'll fight till our flag is victorious for Lincoln and liberty too. Great. great words, words of substance and foundation. There's just one problem. It wasn't the most popular campaign song that was used for President Lincoln. No, if you examine the facts, there was a second campaign song that was in use for President Lincoln. It was a campaign song that you could sing out in the backwoods where many Americans were. Yes, this other ballad was sung in Boston and sung in the parlors of New York, not so much Richmond. But the ballad that was more embraced came from a popular tune, a tune that was written in the 1840s, a tune that was about a horse race. Do I have your attention? It goes like this. Old Abe Lincoln came tearing out of the wilderness, tearing out of the wilderness, tearing out of the wilderness. Old Abe Lincoln came tearing out of the wilderness, way down in Illinois. The old gray mare. How about that for a populist political campaign? Old Abe Lincoln has to come and build it up again, build it up again, come and build it up again. Old Abe Lincoln has to come and build it up again. They're talking about the nation. They're talking about win-lose. There's no discussion in this populist tune about liberty or the slavocrats or freedom. It's about a horse race, about winning versus losing. That was the more popular tune during the 1860 election. How about that? Now, why am I engaging in all this political chatter today? What could this possibly have to do with the scripture that's before us? What could it possibly be about when you hear the gospel, when Jesus goes back to his hometown and he preaches to his own people? Please remember that if you were a Jew at that time, you understood worship as an occasion for theology and preaching and studying God's word. But as you also understood yourself as God's chosen people, you understood that that conclave, that coming together, that occasion of being engaged by scripture was also a political event. Because you believed, even in the midst of Roman oppression, that you were a theocracy as God's own people brought to that place. So that the words of Jesus as he comes into his hometown and shares the reading of Isaiah are very profound. They are profound not only theologically, he is declaring his agenda as the Messiah. He is declaring not just a theological agenda, he is declaring a political agenda as well. That is inherent in the understanding of oneself as part of a theocracy led by God. Today, this is established in your midst, he says. And the hometown crowd goes, hooray! Wonderful! Hasn't our local fellow done well for himself? What he's declared is the day of Jubilee, the occasion of the freedom of God being dispensed on the people of God. He says, what's established in your midst is that there will be a Savior and you shall be redeemed. And everybody smiles, that hometown kind of smile. That's our boy. But knowing what they're thinking, he goes a dramatic step forward. He says, I know that you would say to me now, physician, heal yourself. He's quoting a platitude that was a favorite of that time. It doesn't mean that he is in some way ill or doesn't have his act together. Or if you dig deeply into his past, you can pull up some dirt on him. Although other gospels suggest that. What it means is, I know that you want me to take care of you first. I know that you want me to start singing the old gray mare. Jesus of Nazareth, come and take care of us. Give us what we really want. Come and take care of us. I know you want me to do that. But instead, I'm going to tell you what my political and my theological agenda is. I resonate with Elijah and Elisha, the prophets. I resonate with the last great prophets who were to be the final prophets before the eschatological age, the age when the day of the Lord comes into its fullness. I lift up and embrace the agenda that they articulated. I want to live the way that they lived out their prophetic lives. And he cites two examples. Do you remember that during the time of Elijah, there were many starving widows in Israel? But he went and gave meal that would not diminish to an outsider, to a Gentile. He, through the miracle work of God, gave a poor widow and her child meal that would not end, endless food supply. And she wasn't one of us. She was a Gentile. The old gray mare crowd started to stir. What do you mean by that? Not taking care of the Israelites first? What do you mean by that? Even more so, you're not going to give us abundance of blessing and miracle and wonders first? And then he talks about Elisha. Elisha, during a time of oppression by a foreign power and a foreign army, receives the commander of that oppressive army who has been stricken with leprosy, that dreaded disease, and he heals it. He heals not just a Gentile, but a commanding general of the oppressors. I want to be like them, Jesus says. I want to be like Elijah and Elisha. And the crowd goes nuts. They can't stand what he's telling them. And they get up and drive him out to the cliff, ready to throw him off. But by the Father's grace, he walks through and makes his way of escape. What he's reminding this crowd of in his hometown is that the grace of God that will affect the day of the Lord, the graciousness of the Lord, is not simply for them, but will be poured out for the salvation of the whole world. It's like the first ballot for Lincoln. For Lincoln and liberty too. For Jesus and salvation too. At the beginning of his preaching ministry, he makes it clear that we are saved to in turn be salvific. We are saved in Jesus Christ to be agents of God's incredible grace. The agenda that he endorses and promotes as his agenda is not just the salvation of one clique or one socioeconomic group or one race or one nation, but salvation for the whole world. It's about healing. It's about feeding the hungry. It's about love. You know, it isn't love if you just keep it to yourself. If you keep your love only for and to yourself, it's a narcissistic personality disorder. But when you give it away, then it immense love. Jesus comes to this hometown crowd and gives them the good news that the day of the Lord is imminent. He gives them the good news that salvation is within their reach, within their grasp, right there in the midst of them in his person. And he reminds them that grace and salvation is to be shared and poured out, even to Gentiles. You want to know what Jesus' campaign song was? It's not just one. It's all those wonderful hymns that we sing in our hymnal and hymnals everywhere. Faith, hope, love, these three of mine. The greatest of these is love. Amen.